Great. Well, thanks. Thanks everybody for coming tonight. Really psyched to talk to you about injection molding. This is one of my favorite things with consumer electronic products. It's really the core of the mechanical system for the products we build. So in terms of what we're going to cover today, talk just a brief overview of what is injection molding. We'll go over how the actual process works as a foundation. Spend most of our time on part design. So as engineers and designers, how do you actually design a part that's suitable for injection molding versus machining or die casting or stamping? There's really a unique set of design constraints that you want to follow as in terms of best practice to make the best use of this process. Then we'll talk about the materials that you actually will mold your part out of. They all have very different characteristics, and it's important to pick the right resin for what you're trying to do. Some of the tips and tricks of the trade that I've learned over the last couple years that you might find useful. And then after you're molding a part, you know, what's the nomenclature in a shot so you know how to describe the different parts. And then finally, after you've gone through that, how do you actually make the tools? And this is something where most likely you're not going to be making your own tools, but it's good to have a working knowledge of, you know, what are the different parts of the tools and how does the process work. And as always, we're super informal here, so please jump in with questions. That's what makes it interesting. Or if you have comments, some of you I know have really deep experience in this, so feel free to share your own stories or jump in with anything. Cool. So in terms of the overview, a couple of resources that I really like are Plastic Design for Injection Molding. This is just a phenomenal source of knowledge, and we'll go into a lot of detail about actually how to design a part to be molded.
And is that the UMass Lowell guy?
I
think I met him.
He may be. That's an awesome question. I'm not sure.
I know his last name's Molloy.
Yeah, we'll have to. I'll look offline and see. UMass Lowell. Yep. Bang. Nice. So, local guy, which is awesome. And then also another local firm, Product Design for Manufacture and Assembly, which is just a great resource, not only for injection molding, but really all of the different high volume techniques you might look at. And then a third resource, which I can pass around, is Protomold. So this is a US-based quick turn injection molding shop. And what they've done here is created this cool cube with a bunch of living hinges and examples of ribs and bosses and pockets, sink marks, different surface finishes, which is just a great thing to be able to hold in your hand and look at. So pass that around so you can check that out. Okay, so what are some of the parts that you might want to mold? And I'll sing through this. Well, often, as I say, we do a lot of consumer electronic products where cost, quality, and schedule are super important. So things like housings. So this is a Black & Decker saber saw. And you can see that there's a lot of different features going on here, from different locating features to screw bosses, to alignment parts for the reciprocating blade, to motor mounts. They're really good when you've got to integrate a lot of parts in a very cost-effective manner. So I'll pass this around. So I'll send it over to you, Tom.
Thank you.
And here's a few other parts, just so you can see a variety of different things, and those will fit together. Transmissions, and by this I don't necessarily mean something sitting in a car, but when we think of the world from mechanical design, which is another series we'll have at Dragon, there's really structures, which are the frames that hold things, transmissions, which transmit powers, so that would be gears, belts, chains, pulleys, things like that, and then power sources, so motors and what have you. So any sort of power transmission, if in the right parameters, could be a great great thing to use for injection molding, like gears. And I've got some examples of gears, which I'll pass one around now, and then I'll talk a little bit more about them later. So, you know, what are some of the advantages of injection molding? Let me get these up here. Well, one, it's possible, as we saw with the saber saw housing, to create really highly complex parts that if you look at other competing fabrication techniques, you wouldn't necessarily want to CNC all of those parts out because it'd be very time consuming and expensive. It's a great way to use plastics, which are super lightweight, and if you design them so they have some sort of a section, it can be very stiff and very cost effective. They're really good for high volume production. So if you're going to build 5 units, you're probably not thinking about injection molding, because as we'll see at the end of this talk, there's all this tooling that has to go along with it, and it just would be a lot of overhead or a long run short slide. But if you're looking at, say, building a Pebble watch or a Roomba, you know, those are pretty high volume stuff. We used to build about 40,000 Roombas a week, and in that case, you just couldn't CNC it in time. You'd want to mold it. They have typically very low scrap rates. Now, it does depend on the piece. Like, again, for gears, you can see the gears at the bottom, which is the part we care about, and that would be an example of a transmission. And then this is the runner and the sprue and the tail end of the gates, which would be scrap. So it does depend on what you're building, but on average, you know, it's a pretty efficient way to build a part. Again, comparing it to CNC, where you end up hogging away a lot of what you're trying to build. They're very, very repeatable. So every part, you know, once you've got the machine set up, is going to be very similar to the last part, which is a great thing for high volume. And they also have a really nice surface finish. So in some cases, we can get mirror spark finish, which is an incredibly smooth one. And there's an example of that on the Proto Labs. It's the SP2, I think, is what they have there. So those are all examples of, you know, if you're considering these things, injection molding might be a good fit for that. And also, just as we talked about with the housing, it's a great way to reduce piece count. A little bit of a story that IBM got into the injection molding business when they were trying to compete with the Japanese-made printer. The Japanese printer had, I think, 123 parts, and by using injection molding to integrate springs and bosses and things like that, IBM was able to get it with their Pro printer down to about 23 parts. So just a much simpler supply chain, much faster assembly. They took 53 seconds, I think down to about 3 or 4 seconds for assembly, for at least components of it. So there's a lot of very strong advantages for integration of your components. On the negative side, you know, one, we talked about the tooling costs. So, and as I'll show you at the end, you know, to make a shot about this size probably requires a tool about this big, and that tool is going to take 6 to 8 weeks to build. So you have to add on that on top of the rest of your schedule. And you could almost think of it like tooling is its own project in itself. It's as much an art and a science as doing this design. And it's expensive. You know, the tool to make this is probably $8,000 to $10,000. So not cheap. It's very difficult to make changes. So tools are made out of steel typically, or maybe aluminum. And steel is hard. So if you want to add plastic, that's pretty easy. You can always machine away. But if you want to take away plastic, then you have to get out the welder and fill in the spot that you want to take away the plastic. So it's not a very forgiving or rapid prototyping technology. CNC would be much better for that. And then large undercuts. And by an undercut, I mean an area that if you're trying to open a two-plate mold would cause the mold to become locked. Those are very difficult, and well, they're not very difficult. They're a little bit more costly in injection molding. So you want to use some clever design, either through shutoffs or lifters, to be able to navigate around that. And we'll talk about that in a sec. Otherwise, the part won't come out of the tool.
What is CNC?
Oh, sorry, computer numeric controlled machining. So think of if you're familiar with a bridge port, which is a vertical turret lathe. Vertical turret mill. It's basically a CNC is basically using a computer to drive a machine that will mill out or turn whatever part you're trying to create. Okay. So it's a subtractive process.
Okay.
Whereas injection molding is, and we'll go into a lot more detail, is squirting a molten melt into a cavity to take the shape of whatever part you want to build. That's a great question, and definitely jump in if I use something that's not familiar. We'll spend some time in this. It requires uniform wall thickness for the most part. So if you look at that part, if you were to cut it in almost any direction, it's probably about 2 millimeters thick on all of the walls. Whereas for a CNC part, it just doesn't matter what your wall thickness is. That's not one of your constraints. And you are limited, for the most part, to thermoplastic materials. And we'll jump into more detail later about what that actually means. You also have a problem if you wanted to build giant parts. So you probably couldn't injection mold a car. But for most of what we do in consumer electronics, you know, our parts are sort of this big or that big, and injection molding is awesome for that. The problem is you get too big, then the mold size gets enormous, and that's really expensive. And then the press that actually the mold fits into gets quite big. So we work with a few factories that have 1,000-ton presses, which are as big as this room. It's like the size of a locomotive, which are amazing to see, but it's a hugely expensive piece of capital equipment.
Are there any strength differences between the two processes?
Between CNC and, yes, so it would depend on, like, there are certainly different geometries that you would design for depending on what process, and then the materials you'd use might be slightly different. So if you were to CNC this, you know, it'd be very, very challenging, especially for these pockets in right. here that could certainly impact the strength. And that you can make some trade-offs. You know, usually the thing I would look at here is volume. If I needed one of these, I would probably design it very differently, but CNC it. And if I need 100,000 of them, you know, I'd go a different approach to hit whatever the strength requirements were.
Is there a marriage of 3D printing and mold making?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I've seen, I don't think it's very mature yet, but it's sort of at the early stage. And where I've seen it is a company up in Rochester, New York called Harbeck is doing some cool metal 3D printing, so like sintered metal, okay. where they'll print a mold. So it's a very quick, instead of 6 to 8 weeks, maybe it's 24 hours. And you can do things you can't machine with 3D printing, of course. Yeah. Like imagine a helical, if you wanted to have a helical shape. The challenge is the surface finish on 3D printed parts is not where you'd right. probably want it. So then you have to go and touch it with the tool. And by the time you've done that, it starts to get to be the same cost as a conventional one, but as 3D printing gets better and better, you know, it'd be really exciting to see it go in that direction because it just yeah. gives you a whole new degrees of freedom.
The ones I've heard about are mostly to do with having very complex coolant passages.
Yes, yep, and the cooling passages, we'll definitely dive into that, but and we'll get into it when you look at the different cycle or different parts of the injection molding process. So that's sort of the pros and cons of when you might use injection molding or when a different process would be easier. In terms of the way the actual process works, so here's a picture of an injection molding press. Let's see if I have this here. You basically put your virgin resin, which is looks like little ball bearings, a little bit more tubular, into the hopper. You typically dry it for a while because it has moisture and you don't want to get burn marks. It's fed down into this screw, which is like a giant meat grinder. And in the barrel, there's typically, say, 4 different heating stages. As we'll look at one of the material spec sheets, it tells you how hot to heat each stage along the way. It melts the resin into what's called a melt. And then this plunger will push forward with the equivalent of a shot or however much resin you want to push into the tool. And that's the tool and the mold are interchangeable. They'll squirt into the cavity. And at this time, the tool is clamped shut and it's filled with the resin. Then you need to have it pack. And at that time, the gate, which is the entry point for the resin, is going to freeze. And that keeps all the resin inside so it doesn't flow out again. The melt changes from more of a it's not really liquid, but think of it like toothpaste into a solid. We go through the cooling cycle, which is where the water jackets come in. So typically you'll flow water through the tool and that changes it back.
Scott?
Yes.
I've heard the plastic called resin.
Yes.
Often. But to me, I'm like familiar with like epoxy resins, but the resin isn't really liquid. Or can you explain that?
Yeah, just generically, it's called for whatever reason we call it resin. But you're right; it's very much hard.
Pellets,
like
right?
It's chopped up plastic. It's little plastic beads. Yep. But it's it's definitely not epoxy. But you're right; being a good sailor, you know, epoxy or resin is also the same name.
Yeah. Why the multiple heating stages?
That's a great question. So my understanding is that you don't want to shock the resin by heating it up too quickly, but you want to gradually get it up to the right temperature.
Okay, but all the resin goes through all the stages, and at the end of the four stages, then it's happy to be put in the mold?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. Yeah, and we'll look, I have a data sheet, so we can look and see how it progresses. And then the final stage is the injection, so you've got to get the part out of the tool. So here's just some footage we took over in China, where the machine probably goes the length of this wall. This is a robot arm coming down it's got a couple suction cups to pick up the part after it's ejected, so it shoots down. And then there's the parts that were just shot. Here's the sprue and runners. Let's see if we have here's another shot of that. So this, if you can see it in there, that's the tool opening. It's a three-part mold. That's the cavity, and then these are the parts that are coming out of it. And that has a living hinge, which is pretty cool.
Wow.
So. And then he's trimming the gate right there.
What item's used for, is it just
I think it's just like a storage, pretty simple storage product. And then at the end, he has an X-Acto knife and is just trimming off the gate, which is where the resin goes in.
He's restarting the cycle just by shutting the door.
Yes, yep, there's a switch that triggers it. And then there's a bunch of safety interlocks so that if the door is open, the mold can't clamp because these things clamp with just tremendous forces. And so that's just a quick overview of how the process works. Where I want to spend most of our time is how do you design parts for injection molding? Because typically what happens is when you pick a great CM, they'll have a lot of domain expertise in actually how you make the tool and then running the tool to create the parts. But it's always useful to have a working knowledge of the whole process. So resin. So the way to think of it when it's melted is it's not really a liquid, but it's more like toothpaste or the consistency of toothpaste. It's going in under very high temperature and pressure, so about 12,000 psi for ABS at roughly 440 degrees Fahrenheit. So the stuff's hot and it's really being squished in, which is why you have these giant like 100-ton presses to be able to handle that amount of force. One of the key things you'll always face with injection molding and also die casting is the idea of shrinkage. So as you put your resin into the tool, it's going to shrink up during the cooling cycle, and that will impact the dimensions, of course. Every resin shrinks slightly differently, which also makes it more complex, because imagine you designed a tool for ABS, which is one of the resins, and then at some stage you decided, oh, well, maybe I want to use polypropylene. Well, they both shrink at very, very different things, so you can't just switch from one to the other. You kind of have to get that decision right in the beginning. Otherwise, you have to start over and make a whole new set of tools. And this will also greatly impact something that we call draft, which is the angle of the walls to make sure that the part can be ejected. And we'll spend a little bit more time on that in a sec.
There are a couple resins that you can kind of switch out.
Yes, that's awesome. So one of our favorite moves, and we'll talk about this at the end, is switching on ABS and polycarbonate. They're both from the styrene family. So suppose you build a part out of ABS, and which is usually for a housing, you'd use ABS, like that's your first go-to resin, but you drop it and it's shattering and you need better impact. then you'd probably want to blend in some polycarbonate because that has great impact properties. So you could do a mix of the two, or you could even go all the way to polycarbonate because their shrinkage is exactly the same because they're from the same chemical family. So that's one of the moves you can have in your back pocket. It gets a little tricky because PC flows like molasses in January, so you need ideally a much bigger runner to allow that to funnel in.
And
so your mold life is going to be less, but in kind of in a fix, you can make it work.
Is there a significant cost differential between these different resins?
There can be. Yeah, PC and ABS are roughly on par, or they're not substantially different. But if you go to like elastomerics like Kraton, you know, that can be 5 or 10 times the price of ABS. So some of the highly engineered can get much more expensive. So here's some basic design guidelines. What we always say is for anything you're doing, if you can, you want to design for a 2 millimeter wall thickness. And you want to do that uniform. The range that we've seen is if depending on what resin you use, like if you use nylon, it flows like water, so you can go down to 0.5 millimeter. And then you can also go up to about 4 millimeters as well. But sort of your default should be designing everything for 2 millimeters, which means in your CAD package, you're gonna do a lot of shelling. That's gonna be a really important part of the process. When you have a rib, and that's all of these internal structures, we typically say you want to do about 80% your wall thickness. So if you've got a 2 millimeter wall, that's a 1.6 millimeter rib. And as you look at these, you'll see they're a little bit thinner. The reason you want to do that is to avoid sink marks on the backside, because is remembering that resin is going to shrink over time. As it shrinks, the material needs to come from somewhere, and that will create an aesthetic imperfection. So if you do a little thinner rib, it tends to minimize that. And I'll also talk about some techniques you can do to hide the ribs. But you know, this is a pretty nicely designed part. They've got a little texture on it as well, which helps hide any sins. So most of these ribs you'd want to do about 1.6.
Hey, Scott?
Yes.
You mentioned the ribs being 1.8, 1.6.
Yeah.
What about fillets? Imagine if you do a large fillet, then that would totally mess that up.
Yes.
So you want a small fillet.
Yeah, so exactly, and you'd want to fill it on both sides if you can. But that's, as we look at the ribs and adding draft, you'll see they do get very fat at the bottom, and that can create some problems. Okay. And those are all things to navigate. And I've got some pictures coming up to highlight that. So draft, and I have a little short video, but draft is basically putting an angle on it, so on the part so it will eject from the tool, otherwise it will tend to scratch. So everything you do is going to have draft if it has a vertical wall. And in general, a good starting point is about 0.5 degrees. If you've got a really heavy texture, suppose you've decided it needs to be alligator skin, you know, that's got a lot of, it would create a lot of potential undercuts. Then your draft might be 2 or 3 degrees. But in general, figure, you know, about a 0.5 degree. And it's always more on what we call the core side, or that's the part that, on the internal part, the part you've designed is going to snug onto due to the shrinkage. So drafts and the other part is rounds to allow the resin to flow nicely inside the cavity. You typically, except for the parting line, don't want any sharp corners. And again, I'll show you some pictures of that. If possible, you want a planar parting line. And the parting line is pretty much every tool is at least two plates. That are two halves that go together. Where they meet is called the parting line. If you can make that planar, you'll make your tool much simpler and a lot less expensive. So for this part, it's not, it's not planar because it jumps up here, but it's not terribly far off. The tolerance is a function of the resin, so some resins you can hold a little bit tighter tolerance on. These are just some baseline tolerances for ABS. So in general, it's plus or minus 0.1 millimeter. And then on a hole, you can do plus or minus 0.05 millimeters. But again, as you actually design your part, you want to look up in a table just to make sure you're within spec for whatever resin you're using. And then the surface finish can be quite good. It's about the equivalent of 6,000 grit sandpaper. And the Proto Labs cube is a great example of what you can do there. We would typically call that mirror spark finish if you use a plunge EDM. So you can get some good, good almost lens quality finishes there. Here's just a very typical part. You can see we've shelled it out. We've got the uniform wall thicknesses. We've got a couple of screw bosses here that will have two interlocking parts to locate the two halves as they go together. We've added a few gussets around this boss to keep it straight so it doesn't fall out of alignment. This hole here, you'll see that as you're looking at the part, like this is how the tool would open, there's a piece of steel that's going to be in there. And if you don't do something special, that's going to create a huge problem because the part's going to get jammed up in the tool. It's going to lock the die. So here you'd actually need a slide, which would be a pin that would pull out of the way before the tool opens up again. So very, very doable, and round is easy. Here's a little bit more clever way to do it with a shutoff, so that the bottom, cavity side is forming that hole that you actually don't need to do a slide for that. And I think everything else is pretty straightforward. So just going on the 2 millimeter wall thickness, and you'll spend a lot of time getting this right. In this example, you can see we've got these square corners, which makes it difficult for the mill to flow. There's probably going to be a lot of shear going on here, which can create internal stresses as you mold the part. Whereas adding the rounds on here creates a much better flow path as the mill enters the cavity. And here's this is what you're talking about, Jeff. You know, this is a really nice one that is uniform wall thickness and easy for the mill to flow. Here, if you don't get your fillets and rounds balanced, you're going to have a really thick wall, and it's going to have trouble cooling. You probably get some significant shrinkage. Same thing here, you probably get some sink marks. And then this is just a lousy design because, again, you're going to get a lot of shear in that corner. And it's not, when you think of injection molding, like that, it's something you may want to CNC, but it wouldn't be a traditional part that you'd injection mold. So if you were trying to do a part like this, again, great for CNCing, lousy for injection molding. You'd want to core out the bottom and then add some rounds in it just so the mill can flow nicely. So here's an example. Suppose this is a round part and that's your cross section. Do you see any inherent problems with it? Yeah, it's like way, way, way too thick here. Like that's going to create giant sink marks, and it's never going to cool. Your cycle time is going to be really long. So a much better design would be to core it out, to put in these features. Again, you get your uniform wall. We've added some more drafts, more rounds on it. What it's missing is draft, which we get the next time. Again, if you're looking at a part with a bunch of these bosses, your wall thickness here is much more than 2 millimeters. So you're going to have significant sink marks. Much better design would be add your rounds, and then you can either do four ribs here or find ways to get a little bit more space towards uniform wall thickness. The problem you'll face on these two is that it's a really deep part, remembering that we have to have draft. You're only going to have a little bit of steel at the bottom, and that's going to tend to break over time. So your tool life may not be as good as you want it to be. But those are still much better designs than that one. So here's a quick video of what draft looks like. So this is an undrafted part. We've got it in cross section. And then what we'll do is sequentially draft the different parts of it. So, and there, again, the reason you need to draft it is remembering everything is going to shrink. This is going to bind on the core really tight, and you're never going to be able to eject it. And if you did, it would scratch it terribly. So we draft the
the core side here, and we're going to graph the cavity side, which is in this case the outside, and then we've got to deal with this. And this is going to create some really interesting issues that you'll see. It's going to get very thick right there. And of course, the taller your walls are, the thicker it's going to get, which is going to create a cooling problem and potentially sink marks up here. And what we typically do in a lot of the products we build is, with the factories we work with, they're experts in draft and round. They do this stuff all day. And you can imagine it's very, ideally you'd want an experienced toolmaker to be able to go in and figure out, you know, what's exactly the right amount of draft, how do we handle this? And it's also very time consuming to do it yourself. The other problem we have is if you wanted to measure, say, the diameter of this, when it's undrafted, it's very easy, it's just one diameter. But now if you want to measure, that diameter is different from that one, and it starts to get confusing to figure out what you're talking about. It also creates a much bigger model size, where today it's less of a problem because the CAD tools are so amazing. But back in the day, it just they typically would explode on you. So usually when we send over parts, they're not grafted and they don't have rounds on it, except if it's a cosmetic surface we care a lot about and want to say, based on whatever neutral plane we're using, where we want the draft to come off of. So it's stuff that you should definitely be aware of, but I wouldn't bother putting in a lot of drafts and rounds in your parts. I just work with your toolmaker to get it right and moldable.
Are there like simulation tools that will take models and tell you how hard they are to get out of molds and things like that? Or
there's an amazing one which we're a huge fan of, which is Moldflow by our friends at Autodesk, and that will just do incredible simulation of how it fills, your pressure drop, thermal drops, and so on. And so there's all sorts of analysis. That's by far the best one I've seen.
Protolabs offers a simulation when you send a part to the Protolabs site. Protomold, excuse me.
Yeah. There's a and we work with a lot of experienced mold makers, and it's something where if you've done it for 50 years, you sort of can look at it and know how it's going to go. But it's sometimes as much an art as a science. Which is sort of the beauty of mold making.
One more question, Scott.
Oh, please, yeah.
So you say you typically send undrafted parts to the mold makers.
Yes.
Do you then, when they implement the drafts and rounds and all that, do you then put those drafts and rounds back into the model, or do you just leave your model with Illustrate's sides?
No, they would send back the model,
and that goes
into our PDM, so we keep track of it.
So then you keep track of it separately than your original CAD?
Usually it would go as a later release on top of it,
Okay. Right. So
that we can track all
that. So your CAD does match the parts?
Yes.
Eventually?
Yeah, it's
so
just that we don't...
It's a sequence thing. Okay.
It's a sequence, yeah, exactly.
And so they actually modify the CAD model, they don't just do it in as part of their process?
They would typically modify the CAD file and give it back to us, because we want to be able to track that. And if we ever decide, which is unusual, but if we ever decide we want to change factories, it's important for us to own the database. We did the first Roomba, the database got so far away from us, like people were machining and not entering any, like it was all a giant mess. So we learned that one the hard way. But now with the great PDM tools, like it's super important and it's very possible to keep track of this stuff.
And with 3D CAD, you also care a lot about crashes and things like that, and you don't know what the part really looks like.
Right.
Is there any interim step once the design has been formalized, almost finalized, before you make an injection molding tool? Is there anything in between? You know, I know that 3D printing is one of those potential solutions, but
right.
Is there any test tool that they come up with? You know, just a like one-off something?
Yeah, I mean, a few options would be to print a 3D print final tool approval sample. And if your tools were super expensive, we might do that. Usually we've done, at least for Dragon and the factories we work with, we've done it enough that we have confidence that that we go forward without it.
Sure.
And it typically works out. I mean, now and then something will catch you. It is possible to make what we call a soft tool. And every tool we do is always steel. It's just a soft tool would be an unhardened tool. So it's a little bit cheaper and a little bit shorter. You get less cycles out of it. You know, most of our tools will get 500,000 shots. A soft tool we might get 50,000 out of.
Are there products kind of out there that would justify testing something in the market before you go through?
Yeah, you know, that's something where I think Protolabs is great if you want to build 2,000 parts as a beta test to validate that that product, like a customer use test, to validate that it's doing what it's supposed to. And they do a phenomenal job. It's an amazingly quick turn to get your parts. We typically wouldn't do that if we build both in Asia and in the US. In the US, we'd use, we love Protolabs. In Asia, we probably would just build a soft tool. And 50,000 units often gets people where they need to go.
Do the softer tools just wear out, or do they change dimensionally? Do they make as high a quality product?
Yeah, so a few things are going on with the soft tool. One is it's not hardened, so depending on what resin you're using, it's or all resins will wear it out over time because they're somewhat abrasive. So you'll see your parts grow just because there's less steel there. What we'd also see with the soft tool is that it would have a longer cycle time. So if you did have any slides, they're often manual, that people have to pull the slides, which is time consuming. But if you're only making a few thousand,
yeah, there you are.
You don't really care. But when you figure out, if you amortize the cost of running a machine over an hour and doing high volume, then you'll care a lot for higher stuff. Often for gears, you know, we'll make soft tools just because gears are always changing, and sometimes it's really hard to 3D print gears that are going to work and stand up. So we work with this great company called Vigor Precision that can make a set of injection molded gears in usually 3 to 4 weeks. And those are just a great way to validate it, to make sure your product really works. Just as you get into some of the smaller modular stuff like this, it's really hard to fake it. Sometimes you have to make it. So this is just sort of hammering in the RAF concept. So straight walls, it's going to shrink, grab onto that core, not come off. You'll scratch the walls, make it more like a Dixie cup, and it's going to pop off a lot more easily. Okay, so another thing to think about when you're doing injection molding is weld lines. So does anybody have an idea what's going to happen here? We basically have the melt falling in through these two gates into a part. Do you foresee any problems? Yeah, you're going to get knit lines because basically if you think of a river flowing by an island, it's got to reconvene, and the face of the melt is probably going to be a little bit colder and may not bond as well. So you're going to get a what we call a weld line. So yeah, here's your island. So if you've got the single gate, your river's flowing and it's going to come back together here. And with those, it can create an aesthetic issue. So if you're doing something with sparkle, for one reason or another, we had a lot of sparkle in one of the Roomba bumpers and had a penetration, and the sparkle will really highlight the way the melt flows. So as a matter of playing with mold flow and flexing with the gate location to drive that weld line in an area that was not cosmetic. But it's something you want to think about anytime you put a hole in a part. And like here, if you look carefully, you might be able to see it, the weld lines. There's definitely techniques you can do to minimize it. Like one is don't use sparkle. That's probably the best thing you can do. Yeah, there's definitely different ways you can work on it.
Is the weld line a failure point?
It can, yes. It definitely can be not as strong. So here, the face of, so this is the two waves of the melt coming together. Like those are going to be colder because they're hitting the cold steel, and they're just not going to knit as well together. So that's something you worry about.
If you have it on a really thin area, it can definitely have it snap, especially on like a living hinge or something like that.
Yeah, you definitely don't want any weld lines on the living hinge. So you want to think carefully about how you gate things. So here's talking a little bit about undercuts. That's funny, that doesn't have anything to do at all with undercuts. What it's actually trying to say is think about the resin flowing, that you want to give it some on-ramp so that it's not facing any sharp corners there and smoothly transitions. I think we'll get to undercuts in a sec, which are actually pretty interesting. So here's an undercut. So these are the A and the B side. The red is the part you're trying to build. You can see here with this rib sticking out, there's no way that part's going to come out of the tool. So there's all sorts of really interesting techniques you can have. And given the advanced state of mold making now, like back in the day, you were never supposed to do any undercuts, but today they're actually not that big a deal. You just want to keep them in check and not go crazy. But you'll have what's called a slide. So basically this magenta piece, as the tool opens, is going to retract and pull out of the way to allow the part to actually come out. And there's a lot of different techniques here. This is a really cool one with a lifter. It takes a little looking at to understand it, but here the gray part is the piece you're trying to mold. The lighter gray is the lifter, and then this is the both halves of the mold. The cavity side is usually the cosmetic side, and the core is the inside. As it opens, given the angle of the lifter, it'll pop out and can release that that snap feature, which is pretty cool. But you can see it does require some more mechanical complexity when you build the tool. So as a designer, when you're designing things like that, you just want to be cognizant of the extra work and extra cost. If there's a way around it, it'd be worth considering.
So could that be like a circular part that has that little lip all the way around it? Or
that, you can do some collapsing internal cores that will get out of the way, but that'd be a much more complex, definitely a much more complex tool. And you can do some crazy things, like you can mold internal screw threads having a rotating core that comes out. So you can do some just phenomenally cool stuff, but it all costs time and money, and there's more effort to maintain the tool because it's going to wear out over time. One of the things we see all the time is screw bosses, which is how we hold our clamshells together. So these are ways that are not good to put it together, because you can imagine as you start cranking down on that, you're going to create all sorts of deflection. A much better way to do it is, as the guys at Black & Decker have done here, have it bottom out here so that it's positively locked. And then there's also nice locating features, that there's usually a skirt around the other part that will find this boss, so it self-locates and makes assembly much, much easier. And in general, don't use flatheads. A flathead actually has an angled undersurface, and the reason you don't want to do that is it tends to pry the plastic apart and can create a crack. So a little bit more on how to avoid undercuts. So let's see. So here's an undercut. A way to avoid it is using a shutoff. And these are insanely cool, but they're a little bit hard to wrap your head around until you think about it a bit. So the way we do this move is we cut a hole here, and this assumes that your part will accommodate that aesthetically. And that basically lets the steel from the bottom side come up and form that the lower surface of this spring clip.
So Scott, since this has so much to do with your part and the part performance, do you model this kind of stuff, or do you let your tool?
Yeah, we would always do our own shutoffs, because with the shutoff, because it's this one doesn't have draft, unfortunately, it's steel to steel, so you need 5 degrees, and 5 degrees is huge. You know, if you think of whatever vertical height you have, like that's going to leave a big hole. So I want to know where that is. Now the tool maker may say, oh, you know, we can get by with 3. Or you might say we need 7 because I don't want to deal with fixing the tool. But something like that I would always put in myself, just because it's such a kind of a big deal.
How often do you crash tools because of that?
We have a good track record.
Yeah.
It's very, and usually the tool and die maker is a great like guardrail, because they know they're going to be fixing it if it breaks. So they tend to be a lot more conservative, and we tend to be a lot more aggressive, and it all works out in the middle. Yeah, I don't think we've ever actually crashed a tool. Like sometimes if you're putting metal inserts or things like that and it falls out, then it makes a mess. But yeah, that's a time-consuming and expensive thing to have happen. And here's just another little look at the shutoff. You can see the hole in here, and imagine the steel from the bottom coming up to form the underside of that surface. And more shutoffs. So again, the hole. Ordinarily, this hole would require a slide or a pin or some action. This is kind of a cool move that, because the walls have draft, you can create the hole such that there is no undercut. The draft has to be enough, and the wall has to be thin enough that you can get both pieces of steel to form that feature. The downside is it leaves that ugly part where the steel comes up. So if this was like an electrical enclosure inside of something, it doesn't really matter. Obviously, if it's an aesthetic housing, you wouldn't want to do this approach.
Are they pretty good at avoiding flash and stuff around there?
Yeah, in general, it works. As a tool gets older, it will definitely start having some flash. After 500,000 shots, it gets pretty ugly.
Yeah.
But before that, really, there shouldn't be any need to trim flash, or you shouldn't be seeing any. And flash is basically on the parting line. As a tool gets older, a little void opens up, and some very thin plastic will squirt out. So if you look at an old classic example of this is if you look at an old model that you put together, like those tools are usually so tired, they have flash everywhere, especially on the runners. So you'll see that it's just like super paper thin resin that's snuck out. Good thing to do is, so this is just a very basic clamshell housing, top and bottom part. Given that features from a molding standpoint or feature and complexity is free outside of the tooling, it's nice to include this little bit of a reveal in here and have this lap joint come together. It creates a nice interface and prevents you from being able to look through the part to see what's inside. This little chunk here is called the reveal, and by leaving a little bit of space, it hides any tolerance mismatch so that it doesn't have to be a perfect butt joint. So if you look at many consumer electronic products, they'll all have that reveal built in. Cool thing that Andrew and I were just talking about is a living hinge. So in earlier on the video where you saw the storage block come out, what they had done is integrated the top and bottom together because it gets it all up in one shot. You don't need to keep track of how many tops, how many bottoms, and go through the assembly step. And they did that using a living hinge, which is this piece here that will fold over. Those are fairly tricky. You've got to use the right resin, like polypropylene works well. And you'll typically do something called coining after you've molded it, because remember, you can't really go smaller than a half millimeter wall, that you might shoot it a little thicker, maybe even 1 millimeter, and then the coining process is a rounded edge that whacks it, and that plastically deforms it to make it thinner, and then that allows it to fold. Because if you go too thin, the resin just can't get through, and it creates all sorts of shear.
Is that done cold?
Yes. Yep. Yeah. So that's a cool way to integrate parts. We talked early on about, you know, how do you hide sink marks? Because if you've got a really long rib, the nature of it is it's just going to get a lot thicker down there, and there's not much you can do about it. So there's a few different things you can do. One is you can call it a feature rather than a bug and incorporate it into the design by putting this racing stripe around. You can bumps or texture, things like that, to try to hide it. And, you know, with this one, they probably packed it pretty tight, but the ribs are not obvious at all. They did a really nice job on it. So that's just a basic overview of part design. There's definitely a lot of stuff we could go deeper on, but just sort of a 101 on that. Any questions so far? Cool. Okay, so some of the materials you have. We typically use thermoplastics, which is about 95% of what you'll end up using. And the trick with them is they can go through the process many times. So if you think about ice, you can freeze it in thaw and freeze it in thaw until the cows come home. Other ones, like thermosets, you only get one cycle because they chemically bond after it. With these polymers are really long chains, and they typically don't bond chemically to each other, which is why you can mold it. We could grind this up, dry it out, put it in a hopper, and mold it all over again. Over a while, though, it will slightly affect the chemical properties, and we'll also get some contaminant in there, so it won't be quite as good. A regrind is never as good as a virgin material, but you can do it a few times. For the thermosets, as I mentioned, they do react chemically. The reason you may use one of these is usually for the phenolic. So if you have a very high temperature application, anything that's on the stove or like that, a phenolic is usually what you'll look to.
What is the 95%?
Oh, so just most of what you're going to see is a thermoplastics. It's you encounter the thermosets much more much less frequently.
Okay, thanks.
And within those, there's all sorts of additives you can add. So my favorite one is the UL94V0. And I'll just put a plug that if you remember nothing else, remember that if you're building anything with electronics that could cause a fire, make sure you use this UL94V0, which will put out a fire if it exists, and that's the best way to sleep well at night. It does have some downsides, but for something electrical, it's incredibly important. You can also, so that's a flame retardant. You can obviously put colorants in there. You can put sparkle if that's your thing. It's tough on the weld line, so, and UV retardants or any of this other thing. So there's a lot of different ingredients you can throw in there. Another thing you can do, and often it's done with like nylon, is add chopped fiber to make it, or we call it glass filled nylon, which makes it much, much different, stronger. In fact, you can almost get to the strength of metal with that. It typically is like sandpaper though, it'll wear out your tools, so you get a lot less tool life than you would otherwise. With plastics, just because they're not metal, they typically can't handle the high temperatures that a metal could, so you want to be very careful about what sort of thermal loads they're going to see. And on the good side, plastics that are super light, you know, they're almost, many are around the specific gravity of water. So if that's important from a transportation standpoint or usage standpoint, that works out well. It's certainly been a big enabler for automotive. Well, you can't mold a whole car, you can certainly mold parts of a car, and the weight of the car is related to the efficiency. And if you want to, depending on what resin you use, like polycarbonate, it's a great example, you can shoot a clear part. So if you're like all the GoPro housings or things like that, they obviously have to be clear.
Do you use separate suppliers for clear stuff?
So we would typically have a CM that does the final assembly and molding in-house, and then they would buy, whether it's Chime or BASF or whatever resin from their own supply chain to bring it in. But we would mold whatever resin. And then it even, from an economic standpoint, sort of peeling back the onion, it gets interesting because resin is just oil, and oil is a commodity, and that goes up and down. So you could try to hedge your bets, like if you think of the price of oil is going to go up, maybe you buy your resin ahead so you have it in stock, or if you think if it goes down, you hold off buying it.
Yeah.
And all those games you can play. And obviously plastic is in general a good electrical insulator. So this is just a data sheet from one of the common ABSs we use. And you can see we were talking earlier about the different barrel temperatures from where you are. So you can see here it spells out you know, how to set up your press. Density is pretty close to water. Here's the shrinkage. Which again, you never need to worry about shrinkage. The mold maker, that's what they'll worry about. It's just important to think about it in terms of draft, and then the mechanical properties of Young's modulus, stiffness, and things like that.
What's a representative shrinkage for ABS?
Yeah, so on this, it's about 0.3%. So it's not huge, but it is significant. So this is just a quick chart, you know, comparing the resins you may encounter. Again, if you're building a housing, the first thing to think about is ABS. You can't go wrong with that. Polycarbonate is great on impact, and it's optically clear, so that works out well for lenses. POM is also known as Delrin, so that's got some inherent rusticity, so it's really good for gears. So these are all, you know, one form or another of POM. Polyamide is nylon, so that's great for strength, especially if you want to add some fiber to it. PP is polypropylene, that can be medical grade, good for food. It's also super low cost and flows very well if you need to go super thin wall. And then just comparing these values with aluminum and steel, just so you can get a feel for where they are. We've got the yield strength, Young's modulus, heat deflection, basically that means if you had a beam, in this case, you heated it to, I think this was to 266 degrees C, and applied a load on it. Well, what temperature would it start bending? So if you're thermally sensitive, how much do they cost? And then the shrinkage really doesn't matter from a design standpoint.
I've heard a lot about peak. Where does peak fit in?
Yeah, so peak, that's not one that we use often. That's a little more engineered plastic.
Very expensive. I machine a lot with it, actually. Make machine components and machine quite well. Very abrasive. It feels a bit like polypropylene. It's fairly, can be a little flexible.
Yeah, it's a great question.
I was only going to say the other thing you've got to think about is any surface finishing, because we use PC or PC ABS for chroming, but you wouldn't use any of the other materials. So if you have some other type of finish, then that will come into all the other strengths and choices.
Yes, exactly. And also if you're thinking of overmolding or co-molding, just to get a good chemical bond as well. So there's a lot of there's a multivariate thing to consider. And these are also just meant for basic guidelines. Like, it'd be hard pressed to make a housing out of other than ABS, except for a good reason. So some techniques, we talked about mold flow. This is just a shot of the simulation. Basically, you can take your native CAD geometry. So you take SolidWorks or Inventor and pull it in here, and then it will give you, I'm not sure which one we were measuring here, but you can see like the gates, maybe it's a pressure drop or thermal, and be able to very easily figure out how to design your mold as opposed to having to cut the whole thing and then have to move the gates around. So that's a really, really powerful tool. One of the tricks I like to use, we did all the time on Roomba, is remembering, as we talked about earlier, that PC and ABS have the same shrinkage. What you can do is, like imagine we have a prototype, we're in pre-production stage for this, we want to see how all the mechanism is working. If this was ABS, I would just shoot it in polycarbonate, and then I've got a perfect see-through model so I can see all the inner workings. So that's a quick little a trick you can do. You can get some really cool stuff as well. We talked about steel-safe design, so remember that it's always easier in this case to take away than to add from a mold standpoint. So if you take away steel, you're adding plastic. So usually what you do is design your part to be a little bit small, like if you had a fit that you were trying to tune, and you would try it out, and then you can always go back to the, put the insert back on the tool and touch it to make it a little bit bigger. It's much harder if you want to make your part smaller, because then you have to add steel, and that means getting on a welder, putting in a bead, machining it all away. So as you think about it, always think about a steel-safe design, so that you're always cutting away steel instead of adding it. And along those lines, as you think about ribs, which are usually, one reason they may be put in is for stiffness. There's a bunch of locating ribs here to hold the motor. But for the stiffness ones, you could either run a complete finite element analysis to figure out how it's going to bend, which would be a great thing to do. But you also might end up doing your part, not adding in the extra ribs, seeing if it's strong enough or not. And then again, remembering steel-safe design, you can go and add in additional ribs later at very little penalty. And then just remember that the stuff is heavy and expensive, so it's measured twice, cut once. One of the areas that we've gotten into trouble in the past is with the cooling jackets. So this is the water jackets that are going to convert it from the meld into the final part. And if you have an area of the tool that you think may change because your design is going to change, be careful not to have your water jacket routed right through that. Like, be clear with the mold maker. You know, this is a little bit squirrely over here. Don't put a cooling line through it. You can also do a trick of using insert within your tool. So if for some reason I was concerned about this area, I might do a special block that's bolted into the tool that I can always take out later, and it's easy to machine and put in again. And that way I don't need to pull out the whole tool to get it done. There's all sorts of other cool types of molding. So we talked about co-molding, I think on this one, or over-molding. You can see it's got a rubber grip on top of the housing. You see a lot of toothbrushes that have this, like the automated toothbrushes. That's a pretty pretty cool technique, or two-shot molding. Gas assist is great if you don't want to have a uniform wall thickness, but you, for some reason you want a bigger section. You basically squirt in the resin to the mold, and then there's a duct that will put in gas, and that will drive it to the end. So you have this skin of resin filled with more of a void in the center. That's kind of a cool technique. There's steam molding, which will get rid of the weld lines, pretty expensive. And then DJ over at Bold always likes low pressure injection molding. So if you've got electronics that you want to pot or prevent from getting wet or seeing moisture, you can't typically injection mold them, because remember, it's 12,000 PSI and 450 or 440 degrees Fahrenheit. Like, no, the component is going to survive that. But with this low pressure injection molding, it's actually friendly enough that you can squirt it over electrical components as a way to pot them. So that's pretty cool if you're working on something there.
For the overmolds, is that actually two shots, or is it two screws in one shot?
It's two separate shots. So there's a couple ways to do it. The less good way is you would shoot the hard part, and then you would take that out of the tool and put in a totally different one, just like a insert molding. The better way to do it, it's actually, you've got your two halves, and it's on a turntable that rotates, so you shoot the hard part, and then it rotates, and then it hits it with the soft part. And the reason that's better is a couple fold. One is the parts are still hot, so you typically get a better chemical bond. And two, there's a lot less contamination, just because it's a clean surface. But of course, it's a more expensive machine, and the tools are typically a little bit more expensive. But that's a better way to do it. And you can also do the cool things like vertical, like usually molding is horizontal. You can do vertical molding. So if you had a lot of shafts you want to overmold in a part, it's better to do it on a vertical opening tool, because you can place the parts in, and then gravity will be your friend, as opposed to having them fall out. So, based on this stuff, this is just the beginning, but it's just phenomenal what you can do.
Is for overmolding, I mean, it's more expensive. I presume you've got at least three. So if it were a planar mold with two pieces, then you'd have a third mold to contain the overmolded material.
So in the case of this one, most likely how they did it, it was two separate but related molds. So one would just be a conventional one to do the outside, and that's on a turntable that rotates to the other side. There's two separate screws and hoppers that feed into it. And then the second one accommodates the geometry of this, but has a different B half that would go together.
And so it's at least twice as expensive, because you're doing two shots and you have two sets of mold. Is it a lot more than twice as expensive?
Yeah, I probably, my guess is probably a 3x. There's a little bit, so you've got the tooling cost, which we always put outside of the cost of goods sold, because it maybe is amortized at some stage. But then the overhead of the machine is going to be more expensive, because the factory can charge a premium for it.
But it's not 10 times more expensive.
No, it's definitely not 10 times. Now, you can imagine, though, if you do have to make a change, then
you're changing four molds.
And it gets ugly. You'd want to have it dialed in pretty, you'd want to be pretty confident you've got it right. One of the big things in tooling is figuring out what size tonnage of press you want to run it on. The bigger tonnage, the more expensive, so you don't want to run it any bigger than you need to. And basically, this is a very straightforward way of calculating, roughly how big a tonnage you'd use. And the approach is, assume that, roughly there's 2 to 5 tons of holding force required per square inch. You could pick somewhere in the middle if you want to run the math, or be aggressive or conservative. Assume you're going to lose 50% of your pressure just through friction of the melt flowing into the tool. And what you would do is then calculate the surface area, the projected surface area of your part. You'd also want to include the runner, which we'll talk about in a sec. You might assume that's 10% of your part. And based on that, you'd then look up on the spec sheet what's the recommended injection molding pressure. So for ABS, we saw it was 12,000 pounds. From there, you can calculate the cavity pressure, which is just the math here. The half accounts for the fact that you're going to lose 50% due to friction, and then force equals pressure times area. And that will give you whatever tonnage press you need to run it on. So pretty straightforward.
That refers just to the clamping pressure.
Exactly, the clamping pressure. Yeah, and the molds are the presses are classified by, you know, like 50 ton, 100 ton, and so on. So that's basically the molding. And then in terms of the shot nomenclature, here's our model airplane. This is what we call one shot. It's actually, there's not too much flash. So this is probably a newer one. But this is actually the part that would come out of the tool. So walk through the things, but these guys out here are actually the parts that you're molding. So this is a multi-cavity mold. That's the part. This is the sprue, which is where the mill enters the tool and the screw. These are the runners, which is basically the plumbing to get the mill into the cavity. This is what's called a cold well, which is pretty cool. So as you imagine, the melt flows in, the leading edge of it's going to be cold because the tool just got cooled to get the last part out. So it's going to tend to solidify. What happens is it flows in, it's going to fill up this cold well and then let fresher melt go in, and it'll get cold, it'll fill up that one, and so on all the way down. So that's what's going on with those bumps. And then this last part here is the gate, which is literally where the melt enters the tool. And typically for a gate, you don't want it too thin or there's going to be a big pressure drop, but you also want it, you don't want it too big because it's going to create a cause, an imperfection. And we could probably look and find the gate on this one. Often what happens on the tool is there's a person with it looks like it might be right here, with a knife that just trims off the gate so it looks good.
What happens to the air?
Great question. So all tools have vents. It's an incredibly thin hole, but allows the air to escape. Otherwise, it won't pack. And when we talk about die casting, that's they have much bigger sort of overflow wells. But yeah, that you've got to let the air get out of the tool.
Does that leave a little tiny pin point in the?
It doesn't usually. It's so thin that it's enough for the air to go out, but the melt is thick enough. It doesn't escape.
Do they typically do those on the parting line? Do they do like a whole popper?
Yeah, it'd be on the parting line. I think it's like 0.002 millimeters thick. Like it's incredibly thin.
Yeah.
But again, this stuff's coming in at 12,000 PSI, so the air is encouraged to go out, but it does need somewhere to go. So here, just more shot nomenclature, sprue. This is a sprue puller, so it's got a little undercut. So as the tool opens, that will rip the sprue out and keep it attached to the proper side. And then here's the part here. You can do all sorts of different gates. This is a two-part mold with the gate on the parting line. This would be a three-part mold with these pin gates coming in. Here you can imagine that this part is probably going to fill a little bit better because the gate's centered, whereas on this one, the melt has to travel a further distance, so it might be a bigger pressure drop and not fill quite as well. Just from a family mold where if you're building an assembly, you know, suppose there's a big enough tool, you might have both halves of these in one tool. So every shot you do, you get a complete set that you can put together versus multi-cavity. So in this case, given the cost of operating the mold, you can amortize that over these eight pieces here to get your parts a little bit cheaper. And the point here is also it's balanced so that you have an even pressure drop as the melt fills. And again, these are things you don't necessarily need to worry about. The tool maker will take care of it, but it's nice to have awareness. The one thing to pay attention to is on a family mold where you're building different parts that may go together, they all have to be of the same resin and the same color just because they're in the same shot. So as you're thinking about how you design your family molds, you'll want to keep that in mind.
How do they, from a family mold, how do they manage packing pressure? So they kind of just tune it in?
Yeah, I mean, that's where Moldflow is great, at being able to adjust that and get it all really balanced. But it
so
definitely gets more
newer
complex.
Thing to do that commonly?
It's very common now.
Yeah,
like everything we would do, we try to pack it in a family mold because it makes the parts cheaper. just because you amortize the operating cost of the press over the multiple parts. And then here, just a few more nomenclature. This is the parting line. So this would be one part. You can see the A and the B halves. And then does anybody know what these little circles are from?
Ejector
pins. So these are the pins that push the part out. And then in terms of tooling fabrication, so this is a mold shop, and we'll dive into more detail about what the different parts are. So this is a technique called plunge EDM, or electro-discharge machining. So what you would do is, imagine you wanted to create a mold with square corners. So you've got a pocket you want to make. You can't machine that because you can't have an infinitely small radius end mill. And you probably don't want to make your mold out of multiple parts that you bolt together. So with this technique, you can go ahead and machine these copper or graphite electrodes. And you're doing the, you're actually machining what your part would look like. So it's very easy to get outside square corners. You put them in this machine, and then over time, using significant portions of electricity, it basically will plunge EDM out the tool that you're trying to create.
So essentially taking a positive
of yes.
the part and using it electrically to...
Yeah, and then the fluid's important too. It creates a field that causes some particles to go and abrade the part that you're cutting. So it's pretty cool.
You end up with little sparks in the gap. The sparks basically blast material off the part. Blast material off the part and the electrode. So sometimes you have to run a couple, one or two electrodes rather.
Right, yeah, and it depends, like copper versus graphite. Like graphite's much quicker to machine. The copper, you're gonna get a few more parts out of.
And how long does it take?
Yeah, it varies. It's anywhere from a day or two to a week or so. It depends how much you're... A long time. Yep. But it's great also, like, if you think of machining all these ribs in here, so you'd actually be machining. Like, there's no way you're going to do that with an end mill. Whereas with plunge EDM, you know, you machine the graft into it and then plunge away. This is probably about a week to do.
And you can do them all at once?
You would probably do it in pieces. Like, here's a pretty good representation. You know, like this part might be one, that might be one. And
you'll typically rough it out. So you'll do your
yes.
bulk material removal mm-hmm. on a machine, a CNC, on a CNC, and then you'll do the finish with it.
Exactly. Yeah, you'd want to hog it out just for efficiency. And maybe we'll see if I can fire this one up again. That's a... That one doesn't show the spark. Sometimes, like, this is flooded through the nozzle. Sometimes it's in a whole bath of liquid. You can also do what's called wire EDM, which is pretty cool. So for cutting all these gears, rather than a 3D shape, it's just a 2D wire that's continually going through, and they just wire cut it. In fact, there's some amazing, this company, Vigor Precision, they can have another degree of freedom, so you can do a loft. So imagine a square here going to a circle, and they can put these two pieces of steel together where you can't see the seam at all, which is utterly amazing.
You can do egg timer shapes and stuff.
Yeah.
And then you have to like cut them out of the part.
It's crazy. I mean, the precision you can get with this is just mind numbing. So this is looking at an open tool. These are the locating features that make sure it's well registered, so you have everything line up. You can see some ribs in here and the insert. Here's the runners coming in. And then these are the pillars that the tool slides on. And then the final stage is polishing, which is one of the more onerous parts. But to get that beautiful surface finish, you have to remove any machining marks. So this is a very manual process of grinding it away. One of the nice things about the plunge EDM is you can't get a mirror spark finish, so it's just perfect right off the bat. But anytime you touch a tool, you may have to go and polish it, and that adds time to your schedule.
Do they polish everywhere or only places where?
Usually only the cosmetic side. Like you can see here, it's pretty cool. You can see all the machining marks in it and all the history of the part. So yeah, they wouldn't, given the cost, they would only do it on
that. They typically do walls, especially deep walls, just for ejection purposes.
Right, yeah, so it doesn't bind up. And then these are the actual, we use mold bases, so this is a part that you buy, and then the part that you would machine, the insert lives inside of that. This is the front where the resin would come in. Here's the ejector plates, ejector plate that holds the pins that are going to pop it out. And these are just simple two-part molds. So that's just an overview of molding. Do you have any questions?
Quickly, does the mold fill? I mean, it's like a cycle time, but there's some heating, some cooling. Like when the plastic, I'm trying to get a vision of how quickly this is like this, for example, like how long does it take for the plastic to fill that mold?
Yeah, I mean, typically the cycle of the whole kit and caboodle is about 45 seconds,
right.
Anywhere from 30 to 45. That probably fills in 2 or 3 seconds. It's a pretty, I mean, that's a pretty big cavity,
mm-hmm.
But they fill relatively quickly.
So velocity is
it's significant.
Fairly high, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, coming in at the 12,000 PSI, stuff.
Imagine mass production, it's as fast as you can do it.
Right,
it's,
that's a key thing.
Right?
You know, we usually figure for a tool, you can get about 7,500 shots a week. Out of it, and then, but yeah, the faster you can go, it makes it more cost effective, so you don't need as many duplicate cavities of tools, and things like that.
Do you have the recommendations for when you would use heated molds versus?
Yeah, so in terms of like a hot runner, we would typically use that. We used it for the top shell of the Roomba, so a heated. Runner has an element right where the plastic enters the tool and gets rid of the runner, so there's no waste, there's no scrap that needs to be reground, and it often will give you a much better surface finish if that's important. It's a little bit more complexity and cost in creating the tool, but yeah, if the surface finish is important, that's definitely something to consider.
What about trimming gates? Are like sub gates common now, or are you still trimming?
Most things are trimmed manually that we see. There are some, we were looking at, I think it was over at Foxlink, and they were shooting the 30-pin connector housing for Apple. And they had done something pretty clever that they shot the part, just a standard white part with almost no draft, and then machined away the whole gate where it came in, so they
shot it on the top of it.
Yep, and then got rid of it. And I think it was actually where the hole for the cable that went through.
Yeah.
So they machined that. So that was pretty slick. But that's really the only one that I've seen that's done it. Usually it's manual.
Manual by hand.
Yeah. I mean, you could do like a submarine gate or something like that. That's automatically, you know, from a three-plate mold where it's automatically stripped out.
Yeah.
And often you'll have like a little divot on a non-cosmetic part where it will come down and then create that gate
right,
below
yeah,
the surface.
Yeah. And then do you trim dies ever? Or?
I've only seen that done for die casting,
okay.
But I haven't seen it done for injection molding. And we'll often do things like cooling fixtures, right? I like to think of it like orthodontics for injection molding. So after it comes out of the part, there's a bunch of toggle clamps that hold it flat as it cools because
yeah.
It's still warm. And for the bigger parts, that prevents it from going. I've seen annealing where there's some internal stresses due to shear, and you can anneal it to help those work their way out.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've done that for machine components.
Yeah.
It's like typically cast bulks. The bulk sections of plastic are cast. So
right.
They have a central stress area.
Yep. Yeah, the only, it adds more time and cost and one more step to deal with.
Considerations for parts that have to snap together, where the user is going to snap things together and pull them apart.
Right.
And stuff where you're taking advantage of the give in the plastic.
Yes. Yep. So you can design a spring clip in there, which is typically a cantilevered part, and it can be a once or a many. You know, often if it's internal, you can't release it. It's just a one clip. And it's
so like for a battery compartment or something, say, where...
Yeah.
You have a cover that you want to be able to remove occasionally.
Right. Yep. There's a technique there. Let's see if I can, where basically it looks like that. So this would be a cross section, pretending that's uniform wall. And then this is a product that it would, there's probably a little catch here. So you could flex this back, and then that's, it's designed such that you don't get into plastic deformation, or it stays in the elastic.
Does it constrain your choice of resin?
Yeah, I mean, you would typically, for this, we designed it out of ABS, and ABS is accommodating.
And so it's ABS is happy with that?
Yeah, what you'd want to do is just make sure there's all sorts of formulas for spring clips, because they're so common, or there's such a common technique, that to make sure that you don't plastically deform it.
How about materials that are more elastomer-like materials? Like for a snap-on cover or something, where the material itself is going to be deformed. Is that something you'd make with injection molding? Or?
Yeah, as long as you stay within the elastic, like a lot of it would depend on the both the geometry and the resin, but in general, if you can stay within the elastic region of the material, you should be okay.
Like a little rubber cap or something?
Yeah, I haven't seen, truly as a rotometer. I haven't seen much.
And then, how do those get made?
So you can shoot elastomerics. Like Kraton is a great, you can either shoot or compression mold the softer, like lower durometer, more rubber-like. Things are like something like this. And they're actually, it's the same tool, the same process, just a little different resin. The things you'd want to avoid are, and we learned this the hard way with the Roomba tires, as we have many hard lessons, is that it? You can't use any regrind because it's chemically denatured. There's a double bond in there that gets messed up. So there you'll have a little higher scrap rate. And I think this resin was, the Kraton's about 7 times the price of ABS. So it's sort of insult to injury. But yeah, you can definitely do lower durometer stuff. Another thing, anytime you're thinking about things like rubber or silicone, like thinking about compression molding, which is got a whole different set of constraints. So that, imagine a waffle iron, where you'll take the unvulcanized rubber and put it in, and then it will hit it a few times to outgas it, and then clamp it for about 7 minutes. And that will cause it to cross-link and then become solid. But with that, you can do any wall thickness, like it doesn't.
Okay, and that's a whole different process.
Whole different process. Okay. Yep, yeah, I mean, it's very old school. It's literally just truly a waffle iron. Or glorified waffle iron. You usually do very high number of cavities, like 50 to 70, just because it's a 7-minute process. So, you know, one would be incredible. If you just did one, it would be a very expensive part. Yeah, but a totally different beast. Awesome. Well, cool. Well, thank you guys for coming. This was a lot of fun.
Wonderful.
Thank you.